Good evening. First of all, I want to welcome everybody for coming tonight. This has been something that we've been planning for a while with the C Committee. My name is Kathy Hodges, and I'm a member of the C Committee, and that stands for Spiritual Explorations for Adults. And so we're really glad that all of you could make it tonight for our kickoff. We started thinking about what we wanted to do for a kickoff this summer, and when we started thinking about it, Laura and I had just come back from General Assembly. We had gone there to do some reconnaissance and learn about what other congregations were doing for adult education. And we learned a whole lot about some of the things that are going on across our denomination. And one of the real issues that we are working on as a denomination, and we've had some struggles with, is our work for racial justice, both within our denomination and in the world. And one of the things that we learned in doing that is that that the term beloved community has a specific meaning and relevance in our work for racial justice. And there's a group that we're beginning in our discernment in our denomination in the UA about adding an eighth principle. And that eighth principle will be around building the beloved community. And I know that we've had times in our congregation where our opening words have talked about building the beloved community. And so we thought it was important for us to learn more about what beloved community was as a congregation, and to start talking about this as our whole denomination moves forward and looking at this, adding the eighth principle. So we decided we would talk to our local resident theologian and beloved community activist. And so we asked Tom to come and talk to us about it tonight. So without further ado, I send Tom Phillips.
Thank you, Kathy, and how's that for sound? Is that okay? Can everyone hear me? I have to tell you that after two bowls of Joe's chili and a plate of Karen's salad and two helpings of Kathy's brownies, I'm not gonna lie, and some of Laura's ice cream, I'm feeling like a little bit mellow tonight, and so if you fall asleep, I'm not gonna hold it against you, and if I fall asleep, please don't hold that against me. I want to begin with an invocation by the pagan theologian and writer Starhawk. We are all longing to go home to some place we have never been. A place half remembered and half envisioned, we can only catch glimpses of from time to time. Community. Somewhere there are people to whom we can speak with passion, without having the words catch in our throats. Somewhere a circle of hands will open to receive us. Eyes will light up as we enter. Voices will celebrate us with us whenever we come into our own power. Community means strength that joins our strength to do the work that needs to be done. Arms to hold us when we falter. A circle of healing, a circle of friends, someplace where we can be free. I first encountered the term beloved community during the summer when I did a book report as a part of clinical pastoral education, or CPE. Clinical pastoral education is part of the training for ministry that all Unitarian Universalist ministers and most mainline Christian ministers and most Jewish rabbis do. They're required to do as a part of their training. The program is kind of pastoral care boot camp. I did CPE, clinical pastoral education, at Dallas's Parkland Hospital, a level one trauma center and county hospital serving a large indigent population. So the poorest of the poor and the most indescribably intense illnesses and injuries that are beyond the imagination is what kind of the folks with whom I interacted. The program involved a lot of time roaming the hospital as chaplain, knocking on doors, visiting patients, and responding to emergencies. As part of it, you had to do a certain number of 24-hour overnight shifts as the lone chaplain in a hospital twice the size of UNC. And also it involved lots of intense group work with your other chaplains, and those sessions were designed to be at times as confrontational as possible. So that's when I was 23 years old, that's how I spent my summer. pastoral care boot camp, and it was intense, I was miserable, and I have more stories from those 3 months than could fill a lifetime of lectures. So that's all a digression to say that during that summer in hell, we had to read as part of the coursework, we had to read a book and do a report on it to our other chaplains. And the book that I chose, and there was like a list of books that you chose, the book that I chose was Building King's Beloved Community, Foundations for Pastoral Care and Counseling with the Oppressed by Donald Chenoua. And I'd be lying if I didn't say that I chose it because it was very short. But also, I thought the topic was intriguing. What the heck does Martin Luther King, a famous activist, worker for social justice, what does he have to say about pastoral care and counseling? And the book begins with an assumption that traditional models of pastoral care, counseling, even ministry, quote, reflect middle-class white male Western cultural assumptions and that these, quote, hyper-individualized, privatized models are largely irrelevant to the vast majority of the human family who are deeply wounded by injustice, violence, poverty, and social oppression. And so the book essentially takes King's insights about justice and says we need to apply those in our care for them to be relevant to the whole body of people. And that book was the first introduction to the concept of beloved community, which is my topic for tonight. While the term beloved community is most often associated with Martin Luther King, King is not the person who invented the term. According to my sources, the beloved community was first invented as a term by a fairly obscure philosopher named Josiah Royce, who lived in the late 19th, early 20th century, and furthered and developed a philosophy of what philosophers refer to as absolute idealism, which I like that, absolute idealism. In any event, when you hear the term today, beloved community, it is almost certainly in reference to the thinking of King. And here is what the King Center, which continues on King's legacy, has to say about beloved community. They write, "For Dr. King, the beloved community was not a lofty utopian goal to be confused with the rapturous image of the peaceable kingdom in which lions and lambs coexist in idyllic harmony. Rather, the beloved community was for him a realistic, achievable goal that could be attained by a critical mass of people committed to and trained in the philosophy and methods of nonviolence. Dr. King's beloved community is a global vision in which all people can share the wealth of the earth. In the beloved community, poverty, hunger, and homelessness will not be tolerated because international standards of human decency will not allow it. Racism and all forms of discrimination, bigotry, and prejudice will be replaced by an all-inclusive spirit of sisterhood and brotherhood. In the beloved community, international disputes will be resolved by peaceful conflict resolution and the reconciliation of adversaries instead of military power. Love and trust will triumph over fear and hatred. Peace with justice will prevail over war and military conflict." King once said later in his life that the three greatest threats to beloved community were racism, materialism, and militarism. And my colleague Carl Gregg, who serves our UU congregation in Frederick, Maryland, shared with me his fine sermon on King and the beloved community, full of really juicy quotes from King and explorations of different aspects of that vision. And so that's the sort of thing we're talking about when we say beloved community. So that's my lecture for tonight. Just kidding. So what I want to explore tonight is why this idea of the beloved community, and do we kind of have a sense from hearing those words of King, those lofty words, what the type of thing we're talking about here? I want to explore why this idea of beloved community has such resonance for Unitarian Universalists, especially such resonance now. And so I want to talk about the problem of community. Because when I say community, what comes to mind among all of us might be something very different. When I talk about community, what am I talking about? I can say the word community and mean the church community, the multi-generational group of people who are actively involved in the congregation. I can use the word community to mean the social activities, the friendships, the fellowship activities that we engage in. I think of the great big all-church picnic last Saturday at Camp New Hope. I think of the types of activities that we hold in the community room in the Jones Building. What are the events that we have in the community room? Coffee hour, the auction, shared meals like the one we enjoyed earlier this evening, dinners, the special buddies breakfast, religious education classes for children, but we're trying to get them out of there, so we're not going to talk about that. But that's in the community room, right? It's a room in which we fellowship and socialize and break bread. And when we talk about the things that we do in our church to build community, we're largely mean social things. So community can mean shared friendliness among multi-generational participants in congregational life, but community also has other meanings. For example, the community service ministry, I'm going to give a little blurb, a little advertisement here, because this coming Sunday, the service is actually, I'm going to be co-leading it with the members of the community service ministry, and we're going to be celebrating not the community that we find in the community room, but the community that we serve through community service. So if you talk about the community service ministry doesn't run the auction. They don't host coffee hour. They're involved in serving meals at the IFC, the Interfaith Council. They're involved in working with El Centro to serve Latino peoples. They're involved in building houses with Habitat for Humanity. And so that community and community service ministry is a different kind of community. Community can refer to the population of Chapel Hill, or the population of Chapel Hill and Carrboro, or Orange County, or Orange and Chatham County, or the Triangle, or Central North Carolina. I've heard all of those referred to as the community. And then there's even the wider community. We can talk about the international community. And King's beloved community, we might think of as definitely a community without walls and without borders. And complicating this further, and this is semantics, but I think this is how we talk about it and think about it, is the fact that we're known as the community church. And so that name signifies all sorts of things. I used to go to Earruff, but now I go to community, I've heard someone say. And as if this is a community is a very specific thing. As Unitarian Universalist, beloved community has resonance, I believe, because community is such an important word for us. As a faith tradition, we do not share a common creedal formula. Now, Marian and I would tell you that we've had these theological discussions together, and we believe the actual truth of the matter is that there is, in fact, certain theological suppositions that Unitarian Universalists do share in common and do undergird us. But it's also true, nonetheless, that we don't all share the same belief in God, and that it's common for many UUs to feel that their connection with their faith is through those horizontal relationships with other UUs, which is to say community. And so that community is without necessarily the common theology, common creed that we point to, that we all share, often for what we share, is this sense of community. And the risk of that is that community can become an idolatry. So here are some statements I've heard Unitarian Universalists utter, actual statements. And as I speak them, I want to ask you to think, to reflect on what these sayings communicate about a notion of community. Quote, I don't want the church to grow because I don't want to lose that sense of community. I love my UU church because it is a community of like-minded people. I worry that that speaking on this issue will be divisive in our community. That last one is really interesting when juxtaposed with the like-minded community one, which I think sometimes the people say, I've heard that the same person actually say both of those. So I invite you to hear these words written in 2010 by Reverend Rosemary Bray McNatt, who's currently the president of Star King School for the Ministry in Berkeley, California. These words were published in an article in the UU World magazine in 2010, and the headline of the article, the title of the article was "Unitarian Universalism Must Change." She writes, "UU congregations have a culture. Consider who many of us are and who we are pretty proud about being, no matter our race or ethnicity. Many of us are the people who brag about not owning televisions because there is nothing worth watching unless it is PBS. Many of us are the people who refuse to listen to popular music because it is misogynistic and violent. And more than a few of us regard rap music as nothing more than noise and confusion. Many of us change the channel and listen to NPR and love Garrison Keillor in Prairie Home Companion and laugh when he makes fun of us. Many of us are unapologetic nature lovers, and the only thing we might love more than hiking in the woods is building our congregations in the woods, complete with tiny elegant signs that blend in well with the natural environment, but cannot possibly be seen by the street from the street. Many of us see locally. We shop at farmers markets and we would never be caught in Walmart unless it was a dire emergency. Many of us do look ahead in our hymnal to see whether we agree with the words and forget that the person sitting next to us may need exactly the words that we refuse to sing. Most of all, many of us love our UU congregations because they represent for us places of respite, peace, and sanctuary." Rosemary Bray McNatt continues, "How then do we encounter those whose experience of church is different, whose experience of the holy is different, who find the truth of their lives in the music from T.I. and Nas, in the Black Eyed Peas and A Tribe Called Quest? Where do they enter into the culture of Unitarian Universalist religious community? How do people like me," Rosemary Bray McNatt, an African American, "proficient in navigating the worlds of African-American identity, learn to make room for the experiences of immigrant people whose names I've not yet learned to say? How do we, all of us, convert our ignorance into wisdom, manage both our shame and our earnestness, both our resistance and our desire to know?" And so I want to kind of argue or put forward to you to think about that the idea of beloved community has arisen in Unitarian Universalism in this moment as a contrast to other understandings of community that tend to be more provincial or more exclusive or more narrow or perhaps more superficial. And so beloved community, when we talk about that, it's about a bigger idea of community that goes beyond community in all the smaller ways that we say it. So one of the other things that I want to say about community is that it is, or about beloved community, is that the idea when it's put forward involves certain reversals of expectation. That we think about, just to use Rosemary Bray McNatt's example, you know, we think about community as being, you know, place where we all know the words to the same song and we all can sing along and we all kind of have the, you know, maybe the same cultural information. And so this idea of beloved community is a reversal in which, you know, I don't want to ask for a show of hands, but I'm going to guess that the number of, if I played some music, the number of people who could pick out a song by T.I., Nas, the Black Eyed Peas, or A Tribe Called Quest would be, and I'll put myself in there, which is that I probably couldn't pick out those songs either. But it's a reversal of this idea of a community where it's created where we don't necessarily all have the cultural same cultural touchstones, which is that imagine feeling deeply united in justice and relationship with people who you share radically different cultural touchstones with. Remember, I was in church my first year here, and there was a morning, and there was music, and the folk band was playing, and they got up there, and it was the Simon and Garfunkel. I think it was Simon and Garfunkel song, the bridge song. What is the No, not that one. The feeling groovy. Which is what's the title of that? 59th Street. I didn't even know what street. And he gets up there and he goes, "We all know this one. Sing along." And I'm sitting back there thinking, I do not know the words to "Feeling Groovy" by Simon and Garfunkel. But so this cultural stuff is big. And so I want to say that in beloved community, there is often this reversal of the things that we take to be true. Before Josiah Royce, before Martin Luther King, way back, a long time before, there was somebody named Jesus of Nazareth. And Jesus had this idea, we talked about this thing called the kingdom of heaven. And I'll have to tell you, the kingdom of heaven is exactly the same thing as the beloved community. That's actually how we should interpret them. They're one and the same. And so as Jesus talks about the beloved community, here are some of the things that he said. See if you can notice the reversals here. Blessed are the poor. Blessed are those who weep. Blessed are the peacemakers. The meek shall inherit the earth. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. So all those teachings are reversals of the order of things as they are. There's the parable of the Good Samaritan, where it's that person from Samaria, nothing good is supposed to come out of there, who turns out to be the good detour. There's the parable of the prodigal son, where it is, one son does exactly as he's told, the other son is prodigal, and they both get rewarded and they both receive blessings, even though one is lived by all the rules and the other didn't. There's the parable of the workers in the vineyard, in which people come to work at different times during the day, and then at the end of the day, when it's time to cash out, the vineyard owner pays them all equally, where some of them did 8 times the work that the others did. There's Jesus's dining with tax collectors and keeping company with lepers and so forth. And these are all reversals of the world in which we imagine it. And so I want to put out the idea that the beloved community is about a reversal of the orders of things as they are. Remember Martin Luther King's words, that the enemies of the beloved community are racism, materialism, and militarism. Those are some pretty big reversals to get there. And so I think about what reversals might be possible in our congregational life together. And I think that we do some of them, and I think some of them we can actually play with. And so one of the reversals that I've been thinking a lot about is that we've got our, especially in a program-sized church, where we have all these discrete programs, that we've got our fellowship program over here in which we socialize, and we've got our learning community over here in which we learn, and we've got our justice-making community over here in which we go out and do justice. And are those barriers artificial? And could we actually do something about tearing them down a little bit, or muddying them up, or mixing them up? I think about that this book, the Building King's Beloved Community Foundations for Pastoral Care and Counseling with the Oppressed. And if I had Donald Chinula in here and I asked him, so is the Peace and Justice Committee and the Caring Committee, are they separate committees? He would probably say no. In fact, if you try to, you know, in my cultural context, if you actually try to divorce pastoral care from justice making, that doesn't even make any sense. That's almost an official. I'm not talking about, don't worry, don't go out of here tonight and think that what Tom has proposed is I'm gonna dissolve all the committees and make it a big committee as well. That's not what I'm saying. Because I'm actually saying that our work is more, our work intersects more. And that might be one of the reversals, or I think the dichotomy between spirit and service, or between spirit and justice making, is a false dichotomy. I think that the dichotomy between service and social change is a false dichotomy. And so I'm actually interested in creating ways in which some of these can come together in interesting ways. Those are the reversals that I think about.
Can you give an example? That's the paradox. What's an example of how some could come together in an interesting way?
I'll give that in a minute.
Okay.
I'll give that in a minute. So there's other reversals too that are interesting, that are actually people are taken outside of their comfort zone. One of the things that happened at General Assembly this year was that it was announced that the words to the song Standing on the Side of Love would be changed. And that the song would be rewritten to be answering the call of love. So no more standing on the side of love. It's going to be answering the call of love. And the reason for that change is that people have looked at those words, and the words have been felt as painful and harmful and oppressive to people with mobility concerns. And who have said that those words exclude me. And so saying, all you use stand on the side of love, well, I can't stand, so where is that? So here's what Jason Shelton, I'm gonna read this, here's what Jason Shelton, who wrote, my friend Jason, who wrote that hymn, said. He said, I didn't write the song about standing. I wrote it about love, and specifically the push for marriage equality. But intent does not equal impact. The standing on the side of love metaphor was adopted by our association's primary social action organization several years along after the song was written. And thus it became associated with the general work of justice beyond marriage equality. And as the connection between standing on the side of love and our own public justice work became more solidified, i.e. the ubiquitous yellow shirts, or blue as we do it here, since we're a little bit different, people for whom access to our public witness events was difficult, if not impossible, began to speak to the pain of being excluded from these actions, which we have named as the principal ways of putting our faith into action. Despite repeated, consistent pleas about access to our social witness work, these concerns were largely dismissed time and time again, and the pain of that experience became permanently associated with the standing on the side of love metaphor. And so if standing on the side of love is about public acts of witness, and those actions are not accessible to all of us, then standing on the side of love is no longer a metaphor that speaks to for all of us as a people of faith. Though its original intent has nothing to do with accessibility, its impact has become a painful reminder of the ways that ableism has diminished our capacity to witness together. And he says, once I finally understood all of the above, I felt it a matter of conscience to act in a way that was responsive to the pain that had become associated with my song. I can't change the t-shirts, but I can change the words. In the end, answering the call of love is a better metaphor. It's about responding to what love calls us to do, and we can't know what that will be from this. We can't know what that will be. And then he says, if, after reading all this, you find that you're still upset about the change, I ask you to reflect on why that is. I'd like to hear from people who want to engage in a conversation about this, but I'm not willing to disregard the pain of those who have been most hurt by experiences that I've outlined above. And so what I like about this is that I think this is, you know, as someone who is temporarily able-bodied, for me, it's easy for somebody like me to, you know, discount that or say, oh, this is just being sensitive or whatever. But in reality, we have to all listen. We have to all actually be called into awareness of the ways in which our institutions, in the ways in which our metaphors, in the ways in which we talk about who we are and what we are, falls short of being all that we say we are. And once we do that, there's all sorts of reversals and changes and shifts that become necessary in order for us to answer the call of love, in order for us to build the beloved community. And so what I want to kind of leave you with, and I'm gonna close in just a second here, but I'm kind of hoping that we're gonna spend some time. I've been talking for about a half an hour or so, but I'd love to take some time to break up into small groups of maybe 4 to 5 people, and to in small groups, I'd love for you to one, get to know each other a little bit, so don't go to the groups where you know everybody, but reflect on some of the things that I've talked about in this sermon and a half, and then to kind of ask yourself, you know, are there things that the beloved community asks us to think about differently in our congregation, in our world. And I want to end with a quote that I found in a different book that I've been reading from Rebecca Solnit's Hope in the Dark. And it's this quote by a man named Eduardo Galeano. Are you smiling?
Yes.
I don't actually know who he is. Who is he?
Well, he's my daughter's favorite author.
He's your daughter's favorite author.
So I only know that.
All right.
That's
so. So I've talked about this kind of, you know, beloved community as this you know, moral imperative that we have to build, but then we should also caution ourselves with these words. Eduardo Galeano writes, "Utopia is on the horizon. When I walk 2 steps, it takes 2 steps back. I walk 10 steps. And it is 10 steps further away. What is utopia for? It is for this, for walking." Thank you all.